So first of all, Srinivas, thank you very much for this opportunity. I must thank all of you to allow me to present something. And Dr. Reddy with me, who's been so kind to organize this entire setup this morning. What we have is an interesting case. We're going to go through all the details with you, and let's see what we make out of it together. Yeah?
Yeah.
Can somebody present the case?
Yeah, yes.
Thank you, Reddy, for making alternative arrangements for the...
This is,
yeah. Thank you, it's very nice.
Thanks.
I'll start, sir.
You record it, please. Can we record?
I'll start it, sir.
Yes, please record.
Good morning, everybody. A warm welcome from Jagjivanam Hospital, Western Delhi, Mumbai. Here is a patient. We have 70-year male, non-diabetic and hypertensive for last 20 years and chronic smoker too. Got presented our hospital in March FSR. With history of dyspnea and exertion for last 2 months. Yes, however, there is no history of angina or palpitation. His vital was stable. Next, please. On clinical investigation, he found to be anemic, which was taken care. And so in April 2019, this month only, and 2 days before, his hemoglobin got corrected in the form of now it is 11. Next, please. Other vital was stable. The ECG was not so much significant. Abnormal, however, there was 10% 1 AVL and V3 to V6. Next, please. And echocardiogram saw there was severely hyperkinetic in the LED territory in the form of ejection fraction of around 35. However, valvular lesion, there is no valvular lesion. So we plan to have coronary angiography. We had angiography in the March only.
Run through a
next
BMW.
Please. Angiography shows right dominant system.
Can you see the film?
And it was distal left main plaque along with osteoproximal LED tubular lesion in the 70% lesion.
Film you want.
Yeah, please show the angiofilm.
Show the angiofilm.
Angiofilm, please.
Yeah.
You can see Srinivas now?
There is a tight osteal disease, I think, LED, that's what we can see. Go ahead.
Yes. And there is a small plaque in the distal left main.
Yeah.
And a tight lesion looks like an osteal LED. And circumflex seems to be normal, but on IVAS or vorticity, we'll come to know exactly where is the lesion.
So show the epicranial, please, if you don't mind. Stop. So, Srinivas, here we have a lesion which is in the osteoproximal segment of the LED.
Can we have an LA?
And it looked moderate.
Can we have an ileocaudal view, please?
Ileocaudal, yes. Show them the ileocaudal, yeah.
The sound RN.
So it looks moderate to me. It doesn't look very tight angiographically. So I think, would most of you agree that we should do a functional assessment for these kind of arteries before we touch them?
Suppose clinically, if it is correlating with the ECG findings and echo findings with this sort of lesion, I feel it is more towards important side rather than towards less important.
Exactly. Can there be an opinion from the audience?
But anyway, we want to demonstrate usage of FFR as well as imaging. Other role of imaging would be to see the involvement of left main and
osteum,
L6,
sarc
osteum and the distal left main. That way it determines the approach. Yeah, go ahead. I think you're already in the phase of showing FFR.
Yeah, so I think we've recorded RFR, we've done resting indices, as well as the hyperemic indices. And if the camera can show that, we can show you the results.
We are seeing the recorded with the wire passing it. How is it live?
No, so we just concluded our FFR, so we are putting a normal wire to kind of go and give you some
okay.
imaging.
So what did the FFR show?
0.85.
Okay. 0.85.
So the RFR was 0.88, and what was the FFR?
0.7. That's a baseline.
No, this is no the other one. There is a
hyperemic.
This is a baseline FFR maybe before giving adenosine.
No, this is the resting PDPA was in the 86. What was the FFR? 0.69. Yeah. That is what. Yeah, that's the one.
0.69 after.
Do we? Yes. Yeah. Then. Yeah. Can you see that?
Yes. Yes.
Yeah. Important lesson is that that correlates with the clinical finding, the angiofilms as well as the ECG findings. So if you together and that fits in with the FFR. So it doesn't come to us as a surprise, but then it reestablishes.
Exactly. Exactly. So I think it not only is a positive FFR, but it's the FFR which is going to be correlating with mortality benefits actually for doing PCI.
So now you are trying to wire with the regular workhorse wire and do OCT?
Exactly, yes. Exactly, yes.
We have taken a BMW wire.
Okay. The plan is obviously to do OCT from left main to LAD to left main and see the involvement of distal LAD and LCX-OSTM.
Yes.
And depending upon it, we'll plan the strategy.
Right? Yeah.
And the distal extent of the stenting
absolutely.
Also, I think we can decide seeing the OCT
cranial.
Picture.
AP Crin?
Yeah.
Yes, please. Fine, let's get the OCT catheter, please.
No panelist. Any comments from the audience?
So most people, so Srinivas, typically, would you do imaging in most of your patients which involve the proximal LAD?
Yeah, especially when you're planning this crossover type of stenting from left main to LAD, it's mandatory. It's very important to see how is the LCX-OSTM. And we've learned from our experiences that unless you're forced to do something to LCX-OSTM, don't touch that because it's a difficult animal to deal with if you are doing something with the LCX-OSTM. So many times we were worried whether you cross over doing LCX will be ostiums will be a problem. But nowadays with a better quality of stents with open cell designs, I think that shouldn't be a problem. Many times we could enter LCX ostiums later if something happened to the stents also. So please join. Other panelists are all joining now. We have a reasonably good crowd. Please go ahead.
Other than the LCX ostium, another issue is for
excellent.
Imaging is that probably when you are having an LAD ostium, to get the proper size of the stent, an idea, so you have to cover the left main as well. So that is quite important and helpful.
Yeah, other thing is which type of stent you are taking. If you are taking a 3.5 stent, it can expand up to 4.55. But if you are taking
catheter.
A stent of 2.75 and 3, it can go only up to 3.5. OCD. That also we need to keep it in mind.
The type of stent.
Mm-hmm.
You are a big fan of IVUS.
So I think,
before.
I think
now you are switched to OCT totally because of good quality images. Obviously, the availability also.
No,
is
no, I'm. no, so we have IVUS and we have IVUS here. We have OCT.
Yeah.
We have the currently we have the 45 megahertz Volcano here, and we have the OCT. So I. As I've been talking about it many years now, IVUS and all the imaging that we do is not about sizing alone.
Yeah.
Sizing is one very important aspect. Mm. But there is something, besides sizing, there's many things. Give me a contrast, please.
Contrast.
That is going to be relevant. What is this?
This is just normal
size. No. Contrast. We need contrast. So besides it, we need to look at the plaque type. We need to look at the characterization of plaque, like it could be lipid laden, it could be calcified, there could be a nodule.
What so is that it is coming
most of the times we relied in the
Okay, now we are seeing it correctly. Go ahead.
What?
Sorry, sorry. We saw some other femoral.
So, we realize. Oh,
that is.
So, landing zone is a big concept which is important.
Yes.
You don't want to land your stent in which could be a calcified nodule. You don't want to land your stent in something which is high lipid necrotic plaque. So, recognition, we have relied heavily on luminal size, whether it be any kind of imaging. But I think we need to move from just that to the plaque type in which we are going to land our stent.
Yes, we were thinking of anyway doing it from normal
and
to normal.
Yes, I have.
You have better ways to assess the normal segment.
Exactly. The reliability on of the imaging tools to determine a normal segment of landing is far better than angiography. While IVUS and OCT are both powerful tools, and I've been using IVUS for now many years, I think for the last few years we've heavily relied on OCT to do everything in the cath lab for us as well. So I think both these imaging modalities are very powerful, and I think in the proximal LED, I am a believer that we shouldn't be doing some of the PCIs unless we really have imaging.
So the sound comes.
Yes. And why OCT is picking up is also the clarity, and it is actually quite easily, like people can learn it faster compared to IVUS, I feel, and the clarity, even the, because the resolution is very high, it is seen very more clearly than IVUS. Though the IVUS also had some improvement with increased Antonio Colombo demonstrated yesterday with newer quality of one IVUS technology, which was a little more clearer than earlier versions. I think what you mentioned, the 40 megahertz one also is slightly better than the earlier versions, I think. But anyway, now you can
so
he's putting the OCT catheter.
I mean, whether you so yeah. you
sorry, yeah. Go ahead.
It's OCT catheter.
So the so while part of the resolution is dependent on the megahertz, so 40 is going to be better than 20, and 60 is going to be slightly better than 40. But largely, the resolution is dependent upon the software that goes into analyzing these images. And different companies, so you could have a company which has a 60 megahertz, and the images are not very useful, and the 40 might be better. So I think the next few years will clear all that out.
Yeah.
Are we ready?
Yeah.
You have angio co-registration here with OCT or the previous version?
No, we don't have the angio co-registration in this lab now.
Okay.
Ready? So are we ready for the injection? So we need 4 ml per second, 16 ml? 16 ml total? 4 ml per second? Okay, ready?
So inject through the injector, is it?
Okay.
Yeah, we have.
Yeah, so we have a Medrad injector, we have a control. Let's go. Ready? Inject.
For sake of others here, you're seeing that the OCT catheter.
Sir, we have a Avent.
Sorry, go ahead.
We have a very good injector, a Medrad,
which is
a fluid management system. We can inject controlled injection in this, not the regular injector. This is an.
Awesome. So, I mean, what is amazing, Srinivas, is this Medrad injector. It is actually.
This one.
Very similar to the assist injectors that most people use. It's an automated injection, so you don't have to disconnect at all anytime. You can actually load the contrast on it and do a 500 ml and just do your case. You can take pictures of the coronary as you please. We have our OCT images. Can we concentrate on the OCT images now? Can you see the OCT image on your screen?
Yes.
Okay, great. So what we're going to do is we're going to go distally. We're just going to run through the image first. You can see there's a lot of calcium there. You can see sheets of calcium.
Yes.
And as you go between 30 and 40, you're approaching now the ostium of the LAD, which is your tightest part there and the left main.
Yeah.
And even when you come into the left main, you can see that you now stop there at around 50. At that 50, between 50 and 48 and 50, yep.
We'll be going to the other lab in 4 minutes' time and then come back.
So is somebody?
Well, what we can do, so you sure. Finish off this diagnostic part.
Do that.
And
we'll
see the plan and then we can go to the other lab. Okay.
Absolutely. Yeah. So here I have identified the EL in the left main. So this is a great proximal landing zone because even the distal left main seems to be involved because I don't see a circumferential EL in the distal half of the left main. Show it to them. So once you go into the distal half of the left main, you can see that the EL is disappearing between 12 o'clock and 4 o'clock. And as we go closer to the ostium of the LAD, go closer to the ostium of the LAD, I hardly see any EL anywhere around. So even though angiographically this is a great place to land a stent, OCT-wise this is not a great place to land a stent in the left main.
Angiographically also.
So why don't you go to the other lab? I'll have analyzed all this and.
Can we just and try to see the LCX ostium? Is it seen there at that point?
Yes.
Just go to left side.
Yeah. So yes, you can see the LCX ostium. So can you please turn your axis up? Can you go to your axis up? Go vertical. Towards the align it with LCX. The ostium of the circumflex. Yes.
Yeah.
11 o'clock. 11 o'clock. Yeah. So
yes.
That is the ostium of your circumflex. And when you actually just turn around, come back. Just go. No. Move. Leave it over there. Leave that axis there.
Keep
now you move your
move. 30. Towards 30.
No. Leave it. Leave that. Come down to the longitudinal. Yes. Now. Let me analyze it and come back. Go to the other lab. Let me analyze it, come back, and have some images for you. Yeah?
Okay. Now, as of now, the plan looks like you start in from the normal segment, the left main, and end up to maybe the normal segment in the mid LAD and then work on it. And
the normal segment of the LAD. Yes.
And then post the LAD, left main segment with the bigger balloon.
And the discrepancy in diameter between the two segments is quite big.
Yeah.
So you have to do the part carefully and you have to choose that stent carefully, which where. It allows the proximal end to dilate further.
Okay. Thank you. Do your work. You're
absolutely
we'll come
right.
Back to you
yes.
Again after 20 minutes.
All those things.
Right. Thank you. Can you
I'll okay. See you then. I'll see you then.
Yeah, Kirti, we are with you again.
Three.
Kirti, we are with you.
Hi, Srinivas.
Yeah.
Give me. Yes. Yes. Yeah. 2, 3, 4.
4.
5. 6.
6. 7.
7. 8.
8.
8, 9, 10. Now, so let's get back to the OCT images, please, if you don't mind for a minute.
We left
show
them
the
page where the
show them the. Let's show the audience our.
Yeah.
Right.
We'll take out this.
May I just do this one step before I kind of get on because this is a very crucial step, according to me.
Okay.
Give me a 4.5 balloon, please.
I
have just deployed a stent from the left main into the LAD.
Yeah.
Typically, we decided on the OCT that we would require around 43 millimeters of stent.
Mm-hmm.
At least the lesion length is 43, so we'll require a little more than that. We also decided that we would have to extend our stent at least 10 millimeters into the left main because the plaque actually came in there where we could see a good EL.
Mm.
We know that the EL diameter in the left main was around 4.75 at the landing zone. So for us, in my practice, I've been using the left main into the LAD stent first, deploying it properly, going to high pressures in the left main, doing a proximal optimization initially early on. And once I've had that, the left main stent well opposed, then I try to put material down to look at the distal part of the artery. And then if there's a little extension of a 3.0 or a 3.5 stent that I need in the distal segment, I will do that after that as a second step.
connect system.
Connect system.
Forward.
If normally, if the left main is very critical tight, you do this way, but even routinely, even non-critical left mains also you do practice the same way. Because you have to track.
Yes, exactly the same way.
Latest ones
in
go
fact,
anyway.
So no, you know, no, it's not about tracking the stent, Srinivas. It's most of us, what we do is, so I was discussing with Dr. Reddy, and what conventionally would have been done is they would have, most people would have taken a 3.5 stent, which is the size of the LAD, and then extended back into the left main. So here you have a 4.75
here
millimeter
there is no problem
left
for you
main,
because you are long
which is very luminous.
Yes. I understand, but here you need to have a 48,
yes,
which is difficult. So anyway,
yeah,
you can take have the liberty of taking two stents. That's not a part problem. What I am telling you is, first we will treat the
yes,
distal
yes,
LAD,
yes,
then
and
come back.
I wouldn't
come back and put from the proximal LAD to left main.
I don't do that.
Okay.
I don't do that. I do it completely the opposite. Now for the last few years, we've been doing it this way. Go to AP caudal, please. We want to identify the ostium of the circumflex.
Proximal first. Yeah.
So now we are going to do the pot.
Yeah, we are going to do the pot first. This is 4.5 stent, right? Yeah. Give me a test. Give me a test.
Can we see the angio picture?
Perfect.
Big
go up there. Two.
Angio picture. Make the angio screen bigger.
Huh?
Can you make that? Now we are able to see. Right.
Yes, we can. Yeah. Okay.
So you're doing pot here.
5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11,
pot,
12,
pot, pot, awesome, awesome.
13, 14, 16, 18.
18.
What is the balloon size?
So the distal balloon at the level of
down.
The carina.
Down.
Yeah. Yes, yes.
So you see where we have landed our distal stent. You want to take a small picture for you?
Mm.
Yeah?
Yeah.
See?
Yeah.
Yeah?
Correct.
Slipped in a little bit, but it was a little proximal to that. So avoiding the carina.
Yeah.
We've
yes.
done our pot.
What is the pot balloon size?
So here we've actually sized, taken our left main stent and made
4.
It 5 wide 5. Enough.
4.
Most 5 likely 4. It's opposed. We may even have to go to a 5 millimeter balloon at some stage.
Okay.
And
what is the stent which is taken?
We are ready for another OCT at this present time. 4-0 by 28 zines.
Okay. Yes, okay.
So very important for me is the left main stent has to be well opposed before I start putting more material, because if I have a malopposed left main stent, and if I put a second stent through this, then the floating struts will engage with the stent that I'm going, and devices get obstructed. But they, if they are well opposed and well dilated, it's a very smooth passage. There's no deformation of the left main stent. There's no foreshortening. There's nothing. It makes my procedure very safe, actually.
No,
do you do this? Or, do you do this, or do you do this the other way? Do you?
We do this way if we feel the left main lesions are more important than the distal vessel. But now that here we are thinking, sake of covering from normal to normal, we were going. One other important point which is helpful for youngsters here when you're doing OCT is the alineation of catheter is very important. Sometimes if the catheter is not sitting well in it, there is only when short overlapped segment of the catheter with the OCT catheter. So it tends to move
take
out
to
and
epicrine.
You get to, tends
epicrine.
To get some obstruction while you're passing the catheter on. Mm. You need to be careful, so guide should be aligned well into the vessel.
Yeah.
So I'm going to do a 75 millimeter pullback this time because I want to see a distal landing zone, plus I want to see my left main stent as well. So can we go to a 70, longer pullback?
Yes.
Again, 4 ml per second for 4.5 seconds. So got it? Per second, total of 18 seconds, 18
ml? 18
ml? No, not here, not you.
And what is the PSI you kept?
Validate, yeah? Tell me when you're ready. You're ready to inject when I'm? Okay. 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 Start. Inject.
Hmm?
Yes. Show me everything. First show me the left main. Come with the left main. Come straight to the left main. Yeah, come into the stand. This is your
OCT. OCT main.
This is your left main.
Can you make the OCT bigger now?
Yeah.
You're not able to see the OCT. Yeah, I can see.
Yeah, you can see.
Can you please come in to see? Can you see that even though I've taken a 4.5, can you see my struts are still not very well opposed?
Maybe
so here I am going to take a 5-0 balloon. Give me a 5-0 balloon.
Still malopposed, right?
10 o'clock.
Proximal part of the stent is not opposed.
Yes.
Yeah.
That's clearly seen there with different colors too.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, 5. And then come to the distal left main. You can see that the proximal part, but when you go to the distal, can you see the distal left main is well opposed?
Yeah.
It's quite well. We need to expand it a little more. Go further. And we will cross the circumflex origin now in a short bit.
Yeah,
go ahead. Can you see the circumflex origin is at the top there? Go forward.
There
yes. And now this is the LAD. And you can see our LED stent struts are there. We need to kind of expand them a little bit. We can do that with a high pressure balloon, but they are not malopposed. So moving things through these struts is quite easy. What is important now is for me to find a landing zone and the distal. I can have a precise positioning and the length assessment for the second stent, which goes distal to this. So I can have minimal overlap. So this is going to be my landing zone proximally.
And the distal one we have seen in the earlier OCT, where to have landed. The distal extent.
Go a little more, little more. No, little further down. Yes. And now, distally, let's find the landing zone, which is the best landing. Come down. No, come closer. Come closer.
Come closer.
Yes. Further down. Yeah, closer.
Kirti?
We've already dilated it, so no role of FFR right now.
Dilated.
Yeah, that's what I'm asking. Balloon was there already.
Go distally. We've already ballooned it, so there's not going to be any role of FFR at this present time.
Yeah, I think somewhere at 12 o'clock, 12 mm.
This is a good, yes.
Yeah, 12 or 15. Yeah.
22, right?
Yeah.
22,
so 22. This is around 22. So a 23 millimeter stent will be perfect around 3.5. But before that, give me a 5 millimeter balloon.
So I'm worried, Kirti, we might lose you. The 23. Next plans is you dilate with a 5 mm balloon in the left main, optimize the things, optimal position in the left main, and then take a 3.5 or 3.75 stent in
then,
distal part of 23
the
and complete the case.
And then basically at the end, I will take a high pressure balloon with a 3.5 and do the entire LED so that I get a minimal cross sectional area of at least 9 millimeters through the entire area because my distal landing zone is 3.5. 3.5 stent should be 9.6, but optimal 9.6. Even if I get anywhere between 8.7 to 9, I'll be okay in terms of MSA.
Yeah.
What about the newer stent, the Ornish stent, or other stents where you can use the proximal and you can dial it up to 5 and give a single stent?
That's what we discussed that before, sir, because anyway we have to take two stents. He is at liberty now, can take a bigger size stent in the back and the smaller
size. What about
size?
Keeping a single? Because overlapping is always, if possible, should be avoided.
But here you can't
combine
with one stent. Kirti, Kirti, congratulations. Thanks for showing an excellent case. But we were thinking that Kirti will show a cheap type of case with less of operators can do such type of things. So this is anyway a good demonstration of an OCT and optimization. And thank you very much. And we congratulate and thank you on the behalf of CSI and IC. You are also part of it anyway. Thank you. And we might lose you in a minute. And we'll go to Pratap's case and then we'll go on to lectures. Thank you, Srinivas,
for having me here. And I know this is not a chip case, but I thought there's a lot of learning in it, and it's interesting.
I think next time we can have a chip case also.
We'll have a chip case next time for you.
Thank you, Reddy, also for making this happen. Thank you, Kirti, once again.
Virtual chip case.